yo. That's all my niggas that locked down. Word to mother. For my brother, KR's mine. Know what I'm saying? For my man, Dre, baby boy. My man, I saw. Know what I'm saying? My man, T for VP. Know what I mean? All my niggas that locked down. My man, Art Snow. You know what I'm saying? Call me baby.
Yeah, my man, Sharp. Al Jabba, the guard of state. Go and pop the click. Get up, play.
Brain can't even rest. It's hard to maintain the pressure on my chest. Excess frustration strikes. Blood rushes my head when I come across roads with dead mics and whack promoted shows. It's hard, but with the presence of God, I'm true to the game, so I'm back black to take charge and recap. Sure, the time when shit can never be whack. I'm pure, I insert my lifeline into the track. The energy in me is a poison with no unrevealed remedy. I'm spreading like leprosy throughout the record label, cause mine's put me and my career in jeopardy. Can you come see me in the ghetto where it's dark? Well, it's a real Lord's peace lurks in the heart. Lord knows it hurts. We kick the hurts to the curb. Execute first things first and put blunted minds to work. My hurt side and my fam support. So I'm my for the time being, seeing peace, but taking no short, no short.
Stress, yeah, boy. Stress, rush,
One, two.
There is none. The glory will exist when I emerge from the mist in which I was born into. Scorn. Most of you can't even comprehend what I am saying to you, even in my human form, the message I'm relaying. Why do you choose to mimic these whack MCs? Why do you choose to listen to R&B? Why must you believe that something is fact just because it's played on the radio 20 times per day? My perception of poetical injection is ejaculation. The immaculate conception, the whole hawker who stalks bodies in Central Park. Soon emergency services outline that body in chalk. Then I begin to walk away and spit. Then when I walk away, I talk shit. I jogger sprayed my face with mace. She didn't know that I enjoyed the taste of radio active waste. When I'm in the backseat of your midtown taxi, don't even ask me for the cash key. The four cab before didn't pick me up. No, ask yourself who the fuck's gonna stick me up.
Rush, kill, destroy, stress.
growing up as a young teen. You never know when you're gonna get wrecked. Cause mad clowns be catching wreck with a tech just to get a rep. Instead of cool friends, they'd rather hang with male thugs. Instead of going to school, they'd rather sell drugs. It's best to go the right route and not the wrong one. Because it's gonna catch up with you in the long run. Brothers be on the corners acting stupid, getting lifted. Their life is twisted, and most of them are quite gifted. In other words, they got talent, but they'd rather sell cracks and bust gats and run the streets acting violent. So them, it's all about hitting skins and making some easy green. Cause that's all they show you on a TV screen. All they care about is a buck, a bust, and a sweet nut. They don't give a cause they street struck. You better listen when L rhyme is being street struck. They get your life for the wall of the jail time. So pay attention when L rhyme is being street struck. They get your life for the wall of the jail time. For the rap contract, I was selling crack. Stage strapped with a Mac, I was into all of that. I started rapping and got nice as hell. If it wasn't for this, I might be doing life in jail. And some of my peeps are still in the game selling cane. If that's what you gotta do to maintain, go ahead and do your thing. But with the cash profit, make an investment. And try not to go to the grave like the rest went. Cause you could be rich for crazy, dude. Own a house and 9 cars. What good is that if you're dead or behind bars? And yo, it's not even funny. I seen a lot of my peers give up their careers for some fast money. They could have been boxers, ball players, or rap singers. Instead, they bank robbers and crack slingers. Ayo, they used to be legit kids. Now they corrupt. They had dreams, but gave them up because they street struck. You better listen when L rhymes is being street struck. They get your nothing for the wall of the jail time. So pay attention when L rhymes is being street struck. They get your nothing for the wall of the jail time. You better listen when L rhymes is being street struck. They get your nothing for the wall of the jail time. So pay attention when L rhymes is being street struck. They get your nothing for the wall of the jail time. I still chill with my peeps in the streets, but most of the time I'm in the crib writing rhymes to some dope beats, or even calling up some freaks to bone. But word up, I try to leave the streets alone. But it's crazy hard, kid. In other words, it's spooky. The streets be calling me like the crack be calling Boogie. It ain't a dumb joke. Listen to this young folk, cause where I'm from, you can choke from the gun smoke. Stay off the corners, that might be your best plan. Before you catch a bullet that was meant for the next man, or end up with a deep cut.
Hello everyone. Hi. Hello, my name is Nadia. I'm coordinator of this space, Shuhuf Lab, of the HEC Graduate School of Urbanism. We're happy to see you tonight here. Traditionally I would like to start with the question, who is for the first time here? Can you raise your hands up, please? Oh, lots of people. Nice to see you. Hello. Thank you for coming. So I briefly will explain what we're doing here, just about 1 minute. This is the laboratory of the HEC Graduate School of Urbanism, which is called Shuhuf Lab and dedicated to the name of the great Russian engineer Vladimir Shuhuf, who was working here in this building for more than 20 years in the beginning of the 20th century. And we are having even some artifacts from these times on that wall there. You can see some prints from the 19th century manufacturing of bricks. Here we have newspapers from the Soviet times talking about the launching of satellites to the space, which is quite interesting, taking consideration that we yesterday had the Day of Cosmonauts and Yuri Gagarin went to space for the first time. What we are doing here? We are doing research, we are doing innovation for the cities and technologies for the cities. We are creating these technologies with our experts, with our local and international experts, and the students of Master Program Prototyping Future Cities, who are somewhere here. Can you hand, something, there. So these guys are creating great things here, the prototypes, innovations, analyzing how cities are developing, and analyzing how technologies can be implemented to make our cities better, and to how we can adapt our cities to new coming and emerging technologies. So this is it, and we have launched this series of lectures with leading Russian and international experts who are our friends, who are working with us in some projects, in some educational programs, Last week we had Alexander Dubor from IAC, from the Institute for Advanced Architecture of Catalonia, talking about robotics. Today we're having a great lecture from Habitatum Vadim, who is going to talk about really interesting things in data analysis. And thanks you for coming. And everyone, please come to all of other lectures which were there and which we are going to have the next weeks. You can find all the information in Facebook and Instagram. And hope to see you again. Vadim, thank you for coming.
So thank you for inviting me. And it's rare to read lecture in English here in Moscow. So I hope I will be understandable. And if you want me to switch to Russian, I think we can, but it's really not so polite. So I'm from Habitatum. So it's a company about urban data visualization and data analysis. And basically, we are doing a kind of behavioral analytics, but with our like a custom software, which we'll talk about more. I'm a technical director there, so I don't know a lot about a business. And I don't know so much about cities as my colleagues, but I know about technology and how technology inspiring us to create new kind of products, new algorithms. And I think I will start with a video that moved me to this field of a new digitalized urbanism, which called A Robot-Readable World. It's a really, really old video from 2012, I think. And this is one of the first videos when I where I seen term called a new aesthetics. If you know this term, it was coined by a sci-fi author, Bruce Sterling. And this is a term which describes how digital aesthetics of different sensor networks, computers, algorithms comes into our like a visible field. So we're starting to design things like these things are computer errors, so this all this glitch stuff. And so we are also we're starting to look into things a little bit differently. So previously it was just a fridge. Now we're thinking why this fridge is connected to internet and how it works. So, and also this fridge has this smart label on it. So this is all about new aesthetics, about how we can rethink our environment as an environment which is constantly connected to digital. And of course, I mean, it's a real common thing to, right now to think about this in this direction. But what is in new aesthetics inspires me is that it's one of the first times when engineers started to talk with humanitarians, when engineers started to describe visually in form of art how algorithms works and how cities are constructed with these algorithms. So in this video, we see different sensor networks are working and detecting and identifying objects. So it's just a debug information which was used by engineers to develop this algorithms. But previously, this information was hidden by a professional wall of terms like an like a byte, RAM, CPU, GPU, OpenCV, open frameworks, all different stuff, open GitHub code, anything. And it was never presented visually in form of art. So this new aesthetics gave us a bridge between digital, which was previously fully under an engineer's patronship, and bridged it into more world of devices, or of a media, of a news and art magazines. And these sensors, it was already there. This computer vision devices, it already was in the cities. It already was in our pockets. And all this data revolution that is happened or happening or never happened, it was already there. So what we missed an understanding of how this device networks is structured, of how we can use this device. And also we never thought about our consumption patterns. We never thought that this consumption that we are creating while we are using our iPhone, because it's a purely consumptional device, this consumption generates data. It's not creating anything. Like when I throw something into garbage, I'm not creating anything, right? I'm not creating a piece of art. I'm not creating a tool. I'm not creating anything. I'm generating. I'm generating an information. And this informational generators, it's already there. And we are all inside of this informational field. And we never thought about this before we started to talk with engineers, before we started to think why these devices collect our data. Is some kind of a corporation want to collect this data? Because obviously it's like this. No, we don't. We didn't design things to collect this data, to provide this data. We just designed things in a digital. We designed things as a communicational networks, and communicational networks needs data if it goes digital. And this data is just a little bit unexplored. So in this video, it's also really, really old example from 2011, I think. And here people are just visualizing how we can observe a Wi-Fi network connection. Really, really simple thing. So we are using a long exposure photos, which is also used in a light painting. These long exposure photos are allowing us to capture this light bar. And this light bar shows when the signal is strong or low, really simple. But while we are moving this light bar through a long we are shooting it with a long exposure, we are creating something like a landscape. And this landscape, it's purely digital, right? But it's beautifully integrated into our physical environment. So these two worlds, digital and physical, are collide here, but in collide visually in an art form. So this is a form of a dialogue, how we can describe how an digital systems are integrated, and we describe it with the language of art, and we describe it with the language of design without any technical term. And also, what is more important, we are finally merging and blending these two landscapes. The landscape of a digital information and the landscape of our visible world, which is basically the single and the similar landscape. And when you think that these landscapes are separated, I never thought about like a Wi-Fi connection as about part of our day-to-day landscape. I don't feel Wi-Fi connection while I'm moving on my bicycle, right? I don't feel Wi-Fi connection while I'm going through the street. But you are wrong, because informational emptiness creates feeling. When you are in a bunker without any kind of a hole which will drop you into internet, you're feeling a little bit nervous. And also when you're in a cafe while you're traveling and you don't have a connection with an internet, you're also nervous. So this perception of a physical world is purely triggered by how this world is filled with the digital things. And these things, we created it not to collect or spy on you. We created these things together because we wanted to share information between us all. So Wi-Fi is like a communicational channel, which is deeply integrated in our society. And this landscape, it's a social landscape, basically. It's not a landscape or some kind of a sensor. It's a landscape of an informational flows. Of course, it's simple and it's just a projection, but it's still a landscape. And while you're thinking about this kinds of information, you can usually think about like a wastewaters. Wastewaters is just a proxy of a consumption in any city. So if you consume a lot of drugs, for example, these drugs can be detected via wastewaters. There is a research about this. So this is just an analog source of information. But Wi-Fi is a digital source of information. So it's all an information. And all this information is created by consumption, actually, or by communication. So we communicate, we consume some things, and we create an information. But we can see it, right? We can see it because we need some kind of a mediators, some kind of a device, some kind of a mediums, which will move us into this informational, I don't know, hyper-reality. But these devices are already there. It's just the programming languages, computers, virtual reality devices, all this stuff. So it's basically a shovels and the hammers of a modern age. So we are not, while we are researching these digital landscapes, we are not researching another projection of a city. We're researching a city because digital and physical landscapes are inseparable. And we're researching it with these binoculars, with these, researching devices. And it's interesting that while we are researching city, we are this way, we are always changing our perception. So while we are becoming more and more connected and more aware of how data moves, we are becoming more and more aware of how, I mean, how boundaries, for example, changing. For, in this project, which called Border Bumping, an artist called Julian Oliver researched how borders are changed in so how we can oppose physical and digital borders. So during this project, people who crossed the border installed special device on the phone, and this application on the phone, and this application connected to just a cell tower. But this cell tower was across the border usually. So here you see how border is moving, how border is evolving. So you, physical border evolves into more digital one. So while we're, for example, physically in Russia, while we're crossing Russian-Belarusian border, for example, our phone and our information is already in Belarus. And this is a really cool concept because it's actually a concept of our freedom or about how we observe and use our space, because the space right now is a place of communication. And this is why in Habitatum, for example, we're so obsessed with communicational data, because modern spaces are communicational devices, are communicational mediums, and these spaces are physical because we are there physically, but still we need a digital tooling to observe these spaces. And for example, when you think, okay, no, it's too abstract. I don't feel that my freedom is where my information flows. You're wrong, because right now, for example, Telegram got blocked in Russia, right? And I think it's some kind of insult for freedom. And it's the same thing like when you're in a bunker and you don't feel safe because you don't have an informational connectivity. So this informational layer and the physical layer, it's bonded. And not only in terms of this correlations, how we can analyze different behavioral patterns using digital data, but also via our perception of social and cultural terms. And this is how all started for me, how I started to research digitalized cities. So this is a project from 2012, which called a sensor camera, where we observed how we can analyze cities via sensor networks. But instead of creating a fully objective sensor networks, where sensors are just in place and collect data from different sources, we created a camera, because a camera is really, really a subjective device. It allows not only to capture something, right? It allows you to capture it. It adds your subjectivity to a scene. While you are observing this scene, you are involved in this scene. And this is actually how data analysis is structured. It's always some observational bias when you're analyzing something, when you're analyzing some kind of a data. But this bias is also in data collection as well. And this is like a speculative project when we try to show this speculation, how you can not only just map urban data, but create your own vision of this urban data, your own special vision while you moved through different streets, looked at different objects and recorded only this data, not the data from a walled city, only data from your field of view. And this moves us to a really, really interesting topic of data perception, of how we can percept different kinds of anomalies or different kinds of structures in data. And this also shows us how data analysis is subjective. And when we did project for Moscow Urban Forum back to 2013, we researched how mobile data can be used to represent mobility patterns in the cities. But to create something new, we decided that we will not create a dashboard, we will not create an charts, we will not do any kind of analysis, I mean our team, technical one. We will create, show as raw data as possible. So data without any kind of an aggregation. And here you see that here is the Moscow Oblast, and this is a Moscow. And you clearly see that in Moscow you don't have any kind of centralities. You don't have any kind of an objects with a really, really high concentrations of movers. And this, it's a Moscow Oblast, it clearly has an structure. And this is super interesting because it shows that in Moscow region, we don't know, we don't have any places where we have a huge amount of people at the same time. I mean, it's all somehow more or less spread. And if you see it through dynamic, of course. And but in Moscow Oblast, you clearly see the structure. And this structure thing, it's obsessed us because it showed that while you are looking into something, into dynamic system as an urban environment, first you need to look into it as into an dynamic object, because everything moving all the time, and only while it's moving you can see some clearly. I mean, you can see it alive, because while you are just a shot, a sample of it, just a shot, a single hour of an urban environment, it doesn't show you anything. Or when you're aggregating like a whole day into a single day, of course you clearly see when people mostly are, but you don't see how they move through the city and how they observe it. And this is when we started to think how we can bridge two things, a spatial geoanalysis and the temporal analysis together. So historically, there are two types of analysis in statistics or in data science, geoanalysis and the temporal analysis, so map and time. And while you're analyzing some places, of course, you can, for example, I can select a place here and told, okay, let's create a time series from activity from this place, and I will move here. So here's just an activity in some kind of a place over the day. It can be any kind of activity, like how many money people spent in this area, how many people in this area, what kind of sentiments they feel about this area, any kind of thing. But usually when you're working with an urban data, it's this data which combine both these dimensions. So it combines a temporal and geographical dimensions in itself. So when you're analyzing how people spend money somewhere, you usually looking when and where, not only where and not only when, just all combined. And this is how we started to think, okay, how we can move intermodal complex model while we have the map but still has this temporal dimension. And we created a chronotope which looks probably something like this. And it's a huge mess right now, still, and we are improving it. But basically, you see here is that here is a space, which is just a spatial layer, and time goes up. So at every temporal point, we have a map, and basically staking maps on each other to create a cube. We didn't invent this concept, so we are not crazy. We took a special temporal prism from a geographer, European geographer, Thorsten Hegerstrand, which was invented back into, I think it's the beginning of the 20th century. And this special temporal prism actually is a really interesting thing, because this is the point in a geography history when people started to think about geography not as about how we map things, but how we experience things, how we move through different things during our journey. And our journey is like a line which goes from the bottom to the top. And during this journey, we expect different things in its different state. So while you are going through the city, for example, streets are changing, right? It's streets are changing because times are changing. Because busy streets, for example, in late evening or really early morning can be not so busy anymore, and you can experience it really differently. So this experience is really important. And so this is why we are trying to look into community coordination through this spatial temporal coordination. So what we are doing, we are analyzing how, for example, on this slide, different types of communities in different cities are intersecting with each other. So on this slide, we see a Barcelona, a map of Barcelona, and we have two data sets here. The first data set is a tourist data set. It's a data set about where tourists used their Twitter accounts. And another data set is a locals data set. It's the same data set about when and where locals used their Twitter accounts. So really, really basic thing. And we see here that almost whole city is covered, right? It's covered with tourists or locals. Sorry for providing map without a legend, but I hope it's understandable. Just to clarify, this is a structure of a Twitter message in case you didn't use it. So basically, we have a text in Twitter, right? And we have a geolocation. So we use this geolocation to map Twitter, nothing new. And here is another map, a map where we are looking at the same thing. But in this map, locals and tourists are intersected with each other. So we see a map where we see places where both tourists and locals are intersected. So tourists and locals are presented at the same time. Looks like a different area of a city are covered, right? Is covered. So, and of course, in the central area, maybe not central area, a higher concentration. But can we analyze it in time? Can we look into this intersection in three dimensions when time is a third dimension? So here I just rotated the camera, and now I see a cubes. This is what we call a spatial temporal cube, and a cell actually, which aggregates something into it. So it can be a social media, can be mobile data, can be banking transaction. So all this data is aggregated in these cells. And each cell has a dimensions. So basically, each cell here can a spatial dimension for about 200 to 200 meters, and temporal dimension for about 1 hour. So vertical dimension is 1 hour, and horizontal or spatial dimension is 200 to 200 meters. And now we can analyze, but without any kind of confidence, because it's a picture is messy, that we see that this thing it's sparse, right? It has some kind of a gaps. So here how we model it. And now a little bit of math, but really simple. So here is a spatial temporal matrix. Spatial temporal matrix is basically a matrix, a cube divided into smaller cubes, which contains different kinds of concentrations in these cubes. So each of these cubes contains concentration of Twitter, for example. And we have a term which called slice. This is it, yellow one. Slice is basically a map, a timestamp of a selected region. And this timestamp again contains a lot of cells, but each cell has a similar timestamp. And also we can jump into time series really fast here. So time series is a blue one. So we can select a space and just drill it down by matrix from top to bottom. And we will see here how space evolves through time. So here, for example, is Twitter concentration in selected area at 12 a.m. Here is at 1 p.m., 12 p.m., I don't know, 1 p.m., 2 p.m., all this stuff. Any kind of timestamps. So on next slide, we have the same map, but we just rotated it. And now we see how locals and tourists intersects in space and time. And now we see that only central area is affected. So tourists and locals in Barcelona are using space in a different time. And that's super interesting if you take a hypothesis that Barcelona is a city which completely overflowed by tourists, right? But no, it's not. While the area usage is widespread, their time intersection is pretty low with the locals. And we used only Twitter to showcase it, but I think it's more or less relevant. And here you see how we filtered the data, and now we see only a highly concentrated area. So it's basically super conservative. In the area of 1 kilometer to 1 kilometer, where people intersect almost 24/7, but of course we have this here a gap while everybody sleeps from 6 a.m. till 2 a.m. something like this, or from 2 to 6, to 6. And that's it. So this also has to showcase that this is a myth. And how we created it? So usually people asking that. It's really hard to analyze. It's really hard to work with such structures. So we created a methodology which combines an tooling which we have in medical imaging and in image processing with the classical geographical tooling. So basically, we have something like an MRI of ECG, and we can filter it as a classical MRI of a human brain. So it's the same technology inside, this almost as the same data format, but more optimized for a CT analysis. And here you see how we filter through the different time frames and how we can cut this space and how we can look into different areas of it. So this is like one of my really, really old examples back to 2013, I think, 14. When we worked on this Barcelona data set, we found out that here we have a really strange bug, because this is some kind of anomaly, right? So we see here that people are sleeping from 2 a.m. till 6 a.m., but here nobody sleeps, and amount of data generated by this group, I don't know from by who, it's constant all the day. So we started to look into our data processing algorithm, looking into how we get this error, and then we found out that this is just a bot user. So this is just a bot account which constantly spams to Twitter about a single location or from single location. So this is why his or its temporal patterns are completely constant. And also an concentration, so darker is bigger, is also constant. This is one of like a classical examples of how we can detect fraud visually in the banking transactions. And here how we can detect a bot in Twitter. But recently we had a discussion that bots are evolved from 2014 a lot. And right now it's probably good bot has different patterns. So it's really hard to spot it like this. But with banking fraud, I think it's still possible. And this is like our concept of how we can encode shapes into more rectangular things. So basically, we are using a pixel as a basis, but we are not using a pixel as a three-dimensional object. Instead, we are using voxels. So voxels is pixels, but in three dimensions. And using voxels, we basically can encode different types of objects into our spatial temporal cube without sacrificing a digitalization. So via voxels, we can work in any kind of a scale, while we are working with a city scale, or while we are working with an, I don't know, a shop or something. So we can do an indoor analytics with the same methodologies that we invented in Chronotope. And this is, again, how it's all structured. So basically, we have three axes. A temporal axis which goes up, and a spatial axis which is longitude and latitude. And here's our cube, and this is how our data is stored. So a lot of voxels inside of this cube. And this is how we developed a final software which you can try when you want. So basically it's a web interface where you can explore different spatial temporal matrices via interactive filtering. And now I probably will move to more real-life examples. So here is Dubai, and we analyzed how people using Twitter in Dubai, of course. And here is a free, like a carrot plots, how we call them, or kebab plots. And this you see by these plots, sorry for the picture quality, but still you can see that these plots are more or less constant, right? So you can see here is, first of all, these plots are super highly concentrated. Sorry, I just moved this GIF from a bigger reader, so you don't see other areas. But these plots are super highly concentrated. And what is also interesting for me is that this plot is concentrated through all day, constantly the same. But usually, I mean, it's a mall, it's a shopping mall. In a country, not in a Dubai, the shopping mall is not so constant in 24 hours, right? Because these malls are not malls in Dubai anymore. These malls are community centers. And when you want to hang out with a friend, when you want to go to bar, to cinema or something, you're going to mall. And this is super, super hyper-scaled. Not as when you imagine like an American mall, because in America you still can hang out somewhere. In Dubai, it's a really just a single public place. And using this, it's like a simple visualization thing, you can look into these communication patterns over time and confirm it. We think that having this kind of interaction, interactive visualization, which combines these temporal and spatial dimensions in the single visualization, is super important for discussions. While you're pitching someone about like renovating this small, finally a proper community center, not in the community center with shops, but a proper community one, you probably need some kind of a discussion point, right? And this is it. And here is another just a shot from the same video where we see the same malls actually here, here, and here. And this is an tourist activity in Dubai. And you also see that tourist activity is also like almost constant in this mall. And this one is almost works 24/7. So it's probably a Dubai mall, the most popular one. And also what fascinates me is that you clearly see here, sorry, maybe you don't, a gaps. And in these gaps are, when you move to edge of a city, it's everywhere. And when you move closer to city center, this pattern becomes more dense. So it means that in this area, it's probably a residential areas or I don't know, something like this, people are not using the space all the time. So we have here some kind of activity peaks, and here is almost like a dead zone. But in the malls, people are constantly presented. And we see a different pattern while we are combining residents and tourists in Dubai. So right now, blue is a residence. And you see that residents are time usage in the same areas. It's more widespread, right? So here we have a full, complete feel of a time-space environment. And also, this district, it's a residential district. It's really super located in a single area. And also what fascinates me, I didn't think about it previously, but that locals are using these spaces so intense during the time. It means that in Dubai they have a lot of locals who doesn't work, for example, or who work, I'm not sure that they work from home, who doesn't work. And that's cool, because in Moscow this pattern will be totally different. And here is again a really good finding from business districts in Dubai. Here we have a Business Bay, which is one of top used districts, and it's super, super concentrated and almost 24/7. But also we have Dubai Internet City, which has different time peaks. And what we found out that using this special temporal visualization is that in different business districts in Dubai, they're starting to work at 4 a.m. or 3 a.m. because they're closing international deals. So when you have a Skype at 3 a.m., you're at work. So patterns in a business district, for example, here, sorry, so in this area, it's special temporal usage are really different than in residential areas, for example. And this time usage is unique because Dubai is some kind of an international business center, but still has a big time difference with when you're working with different regions. This is how this map illustrated. Also, we did a project for Heathrow. I'll include this one, where we don't like this visualization, actually, where we analyzed how locals and residents and non-residents are combined in a special temporal environment. And we found out, of course, the obvious thing is that here, the red one is probably passengers who traverse through airport, and the green one is the local or residents. And we see that we have a specific intersection points where both of these two groups are intersecting. We did this research while we worked on a project about Heathrow area redevelopment. So Heathrow Airport has a bigger area for redevelopment, and we tried to analyze the impact, how, for example, providing additional services for passengers will impact a local community. And again, we see that using a special temporal coordination, we can really separate these two groups of people and use the same space twice, for one group and for another group. And this concept seems a little bit strange when you first hear it, like how you can reuse space, the single space, for example, this, for different types of people, but still it works. For example, right now we are doing a lecture here, right? But 1 hour ago, it was a classroom. So it works even here. But in New York, they have a startup which co-leasing cafes as an offices, as a WeWork, but without any kind of an hard stuff. So they don't build, they don't rent. They just come to cafe and say, okay, we install a Wi-Fi here and just sell your space for people who needs a co-working for 1 hour per day or 3 hours per day. And since a lot of cafes are empty during the day from, for example, let's say 3 p.m. till, I don't know, 6 or 7, and in early morning, they can rent this space. And this works really well. And we think that this amount of businesses who are targeting, reusing existing spaces will grow, because in some urban environment, we are in a these environments are so dense already, like London, for example, that we cannot build a new property anymore. But while market for co-working, for example, it's booming right now, we cannot really rent and space in a megapolis for 24/7 anymore. It's too expensive. So you need to be something like a WeWork to do this. But if you're a small startup, it's really easy for you to collocate with someone. And collocation doesn't mean always that you're presented in the space together for all the time. And I have next slide just about how, again, all these two digital and physical environments are intersecting. So basically, when we are reading these lectures, all people are asking us how this digital, data sets are representative. For example, we during a Heathrow research, we worked with Vodafone data and we analyzed it for like a month or something. So it was a month of the data. And the strange thing for people who just come to data analytics like this is, okay, just the 20% of population, how you can analyze. And this when a concept of a proxy comes to mind. So basically, all this data that we are analyzing is some kind of a proxy of an activity of people. And this is how we just map and digital activity, digital consumption, and mobility patterns into an urban environment. But what is the cool thing is that while we are using our digital infrastructure to provide us insights about physical space, our digital infrastructure is again taking our physical space. So at some point we can be in a recursion when we are analyzing an data to build new data centers, basically, to analyze more data. So this can be some kind of a recursive pattern, actually, because this is a really simple example of how data gets back into real world via data centers, via physical manifestations of a storage. Because while we are need to do our analysis, we still need to store this data. And these data centers, they become so ubiquitous right now. And it's not only things that we moved away from our cities, because we don't have a lot of space. So we, at some point, we need to live close to these data centers. And this is how data centers becoming more attractive. So it's becoming more like a day-to-day objects. And again, we can, in the future, we can analyze, a redevelopment of this data center using the data that was stored in this data center before. So I think that's a really funny topic about how these two things collide. And I'm done. Questions? Thank you.
I'm sure you have a lot of questions, but just for instance, please use the microphone when you're asking one, because the online guys are going to hear only something that we speak into the microphone, okay?
The online guys can write into the
room. True. Okay.
I will start.
The first comment on what you said in the last part about the data centers and how they start impacting the physical environment is actually a very interesting example in Holland, where there is a startup who's looking at distributed data centers, which they install into residential apartments, and because they generate a lot of power, then you can, you know, use this power to accommodates things. My question is about how you you decide what sort of urban data you use in a particular project, because obviously there's a whole variety of data that could be used. So what is behind your choice? And then also, maybe an obvious question, but I don't know the answer to that. When you're using social media data, do you specifically choose between the communication channels like, you know, Twitter, Facebook, and are there always correlations between them, or can they sometimes contradict each other?
Yeah, so but basically we are using what is available, and Twitter is mostly available all the time because they don't affected by this fake news stuff. And Facebook, they are closing and closing their APIs. So previously, for an non-commercial research projects, we used a lot of Instagram. But right now, they closed an API finally completely just 2 or 3 days ago. And this trend is actually bothering me because while we have hopes that mobile data will be generally available, we have some kind of contracts with the data providers. This is how we work, for example, with the mobile data from Vodafone. But still, all these movements offer like a data privacy, how we are affected by data privacy, and this all hysteria about data privacy leaks, it's purely affects even an open data sources, actually. So while we have worked a lot in our previous projects with a New York taxi data set, this data set, like 3 years ago, it was compromised, and it was compromised by a data correlation. So what they did, they looked into Instagram, where celebrities took a taxi, and then looked into New York taxi data set, and looked at which taxi was took from this location at this time period, and then just tracked it. And this was a huge scandal. And the taxi data set is still available, but there were some concerns about closing it. And actually, what is really bothering me, for example, is that at some point we can come to like an informational dark age where we will not have a big data that we dreamed like, oh wow, everything is connected, all data is shared, and corporations is spying on us. We will have less data than before, so we will have less internet, so everything is blocked because terrorism, child pornography, all this stuff. Data sets are not open. Even previous data sets about healthcare, about spend data is also closed because people are worrying about correlation attacks. And while this thing's crazy, right? This looks crazy right now, but in the future, it's gonna be like this. So we really hope that in the future we will have some kind of data sharing agency or something like this, which will allow corporations to share their data privately with the researchers. So we will have some kind of a marketplace of data where data is shared and regulated. And this is kind of a move from an open data, but this is also a move from a hysteria about data leaks that we are suffering right now.
Hello, I'm Nikolai. I have the question about the thing that you said in the end. It's like about the future where data is fragmented and not globally available. I mean, in that sense, didn't it already happen when Chinese internet kind of fell out from the global internet, like this rule-China conflict?
The question about data openness is not a question about firewalls and VPNs. It's even Russian politicians know that this is a war of swords and shields. It's not a question like this. What I'm talking about, ludism of not sharing data. While you're going away from public services and you're going away from sharing your public opinion intentionally by yourself. So, I mean, it's a little bit different story. While we are closing data portals, not by firewalls, we are closing these data portals by public opinion. It's a completely different thing because you cannot avoid public opinion. It's a dark age, so you cannot just install VPN and go to an open data portal. It doesn't exist. Its servers they are destroyed, so you don't have any place to access this data. This is what completely separates all these recent data scandals with previous tries of closing something, because almost every modern Chinese guy has a VPN connection, and also, I mean, it's easy to install. It's just one application, and you can download this application from browser if it's not in your app store. It's super easy. But while this data is generally not available, it's a different story. It's like in the Library of Alexandria. This is what everybody talking about for 10 years right now, 15 years, because internet right now is the Library of Alexandria. It's big talks about this for 10 years. Like when we have an article on a Medium, and then Medium is closed, we cannot access it via VPN, we cannot access it anyhow. And this is a really strange thing, because we think about internet and we think about data as about things that persist always, like in a super mature, constant things which not change over time. No, it's like as our physical environment. Some things pops up, some disappear, and those is controlled by public opinion, by public consumption patterns. So if you don't consume Medium for a while, this website will go bankrupt. And there will be no this super smart articles about web engineering anymore. And you cannot, read anything like this. This is how Internet Archive, archive.org, was created. For which reason? So this is like a website which collects all the data sets in internet. Not only websites, but also books, videos, and trying to store it. But this amount of data is huge. It's super inefficient to store. And the access speed on this site is really low because they don't have so much bandwidth for accessing on 100 megabits from different points on Earth. So it's a really, really complicated. And it's truly a question for us, because we are like creating new startups every day, right? And we are thinking about, okay, maybe blockchain will save us all, but no. What we need to create, not a money distribution system, we need to create a data distribution system, actually, a real data distribution system, which allows us to distribute websites all across the network, like a torrent or something. There is like two or three initiatives right now going on this field, but none of these initiatives is succeeded, because nobody knows right now how to solve a backend problem, because your website needs a backend as well, and you cannot just spread it as a frontend code. So it's super unresolved question right now, and hopefully it will be solved soon.
First of all, thank you very much for your lecture. For me, as a classical cartographer, it was amazingly interesting. I mean, I'm mostly working with paper maps. So two pretty obvious questions. The first question is about your software. Which software do you use? And the second question is about, you mentioned that you worked with Vodafone data sets. How do you get permissions to use their data? Thank you.
So first of all, the software that I showed is called the Chronotope. Again, so it's a software that's available online, and right now it's in a beta phase, and you can go to a website called Chronotope.io, and on this website you can access it. It costs $15 per month right now during the beta period, and you can upload your own data sets in it and see it in three dimensions, in space and time. We're still testing it, so feel free to write us a comment if you will access it. Feedback, always welcome to all this stuff. Data access. So we have several partnerships with different mobile operators across the globe, and basically we have some kind of a legal agreements with them all, and they just sell data to us, and we resell it to our consumers. I'm not sure how these agreements are structured, so because I'm not working with it. I just know how we upload data. Any other questions?
Hello, Thomas. So thanks for your presentation. Just to add something, because I come from the telco world and we are working on data visualization. It's always a challenge, of course, to share the data. And what I wanted to add is that in Europe, from 21st of May, we are going to have a law package named GDPR, which will totally transform the way the companies can store the data and use them for other purposes than for what they have been collected initially. So we will have a lot of business models which are going to fall. For example, targeted ads. It will not be possible allowed anymore. And the company which are not going to be compliant with GDPR can be sanctioned like something like 10% of their income, yearly income. So it's huge. So I think we'll have a very interesting situation where what we can call open data or openly accessible data are going to be much more clear and clearly defined. And also, I know you are in Russia, where you have under law, but if you work with European citizen data, you have this challenge. So you must be compliant also.
There was some question there. No, no anymore. One last question, guys? No? Okay, thank you very much for lecture. Thank you. So, hope you will have a great time with big data and with building better cities. And we invite you for further lectures, which we will have the break during the next 3 weeks, because we go to Barcelona with our students for the workshop, and we will be back late in May. And we invite you to follow us and to be with us in our next lectures. Thank you for coming.